Hello, church. We are coming to you from our home because we're not meeting at our physical location. And just wanted to say hello to everyone out there in the internet world. We are having church online live. So we have five services that it's live. We can see each other. I'm there. And if you want information on that, please email the church and say, and send your email, and we'll include you in, and you can join the services. We had a great time today.
Oh,
So we've had a good time of worship with Cecilia, and I'm going to get to my message, but a lot of people have been asking how can they send in their offering, and I'm like, well, you can send it in by mail. So my wife taped a funny video, it's a minute long, with me addressing the envelope and writing out a check and taking it down to the mail. So I hope you enjoy this video, and then on the other side, I will begin my sermon. Because I couldn't tell if you would be able to tell if I didn't put it in the mailbox. And by the time I got back, I was totally exhausted. And I was worried that the mailman would show up and pick up that check. And so my wife volunteered to go down and get it because I was exhausted from that run. So, and I didn't want it mailed out to the church. I'd be in big trouble. So I'm going to share a message out of the book of James. So I know you guys might have thought you, oh wait. Okay. Sorry about that. I didn't unmute myself. I'm going to share a message from the book of James. And now you have no excuse that you left your Bible at home. So go grab your Bible off of your TV stand and locate the book of James. It's right after the book of Hebrews. It's near the end of the New Testament. And I want to just share for about 20 minutes with you a message that the Lord's laid on my heart. There's our two campuses. Who would have ever thought in all my years of ministry that we wouldn't be having church in buildings? Like, this is so unique and different. So I've been preaching through the book of James for the last 3 months and not realizing that what I've been preaching on, the Lord has been preparing us for kind of what we're going through now. James is like Proverbs for the New Testament. What Proverbs is for the Old Testament, James is for the New Testament. So it's very practical, down-to-earth living. And there's a time to preach theologically, and there's a time to preach practically. And so I just wanted to review some of the stuff I've already preached on, but it like applies to what we're going through. And we're probably at the beginning of, you know, more difficult days, weeks, and maybe months ahead of us. So I had preached 3 months ago on James chapter 1, verse 2. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. So it's interesting that the Lord says that we're to consider it pure joy when we face trials and testings. And when I preached this originally, we had no idea we were going to go through this coronavirus situation. And it's hard to like, whoa, we're to consider this pure joy, what we're going through. God's going to use it to help us to persevere and to mature in our faith. I was on the news, they're talking a lot, as psychologists say that many people are experiencing what is called soul exhaustion. And when I first saw that in the news, I was like, yeah, that does describe a little bit how I've been feeling the last couple of weeks, like a soul exhaustion. And these are the symptoms of soul exhaustion. One, you have a general underlying sense of anxiety or fear. And I'm like, yeah, the last 4 weeks there's been like this kind of this low level feeling of fear. And every week something happens, or it's like, what is going to be next that occurs in the world, in our country, in our state? You have random physical symptoms that get worse when you're under stress. I get a headache about once every 5 years, but I've had like a headache nonstop for the last 2 weeks. Abrupt changes in emotions, feeling lonely. So, you know, we have we got a lot of people that live by themselves. They're either singles or they're old folks that have lost their spouse. And a lot of people have been calling up the church that they're already feeling lonely and cut off, and there's no one in the home with them at all. And this might go on for weeks and months. And so people are having a tough time, lack of purpose or direction. People in the church are losing their jobs, and they're not sure what's going to happen and what's their purpose in life. Spiritual neglect, I'll get back to it. Lack of freedom or being trapped. That is me. I don't like being trapped in the home. Being around negative or abusive people, they're worried that a lot of husbands and wives, they get to go to their job to unwind. But if you put them in the home nonstop, day after day, week after week, that, you know, people go crazy. And I'm like, if you need to walk, call up, you know, call me up, call someone up. And if you're having a tough time with the kids or with your spouse or whatever. Spiritual neglect, I think it's important that we don't neglect our lives spiritually. I think that's actually a key. A lot of people in the church say that they're depressed and they can't get out of bed and they're going through a rough time. And I think it's because their soul is distressed and that's causing them to physically be distressed. But if we keep our spirit, I think our spiritual life feeds our soul. So if we keep close to the Lord and get recharged by the Lord each day, I think it will charge up our soul and us physically. In Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, it says, those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will mount up on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary, and they will walk and not be faint. In some sense, the Lord is forcing Americans into a spiritual sabbatical time. And again, we need to consider pure joy that God's working on all of us to mature us and to persevere and to grow closer to Him. James 1, 5 to 6, I preached the sermon on. It says, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. So lots of people are going to need wisdom. Wisdom when to go to the store. Wisdom for your job, if you still have a job. Wisdom for your family. You know, wisdom for your life and stuff. And God says, come to me. You come to me and I will give you the wisdom that each one of us needs. And it'll be personalized for each one of our situations and where we're at. I preached a sermon on James 1, 9, and 10, which just talks about the poor and the rich. I'm not going to mention anything other than, you know, the stock market has crashed 32%, and it's like a lot of the wealth of the world has been erased. And I don't know what that means for the future. Hopefully a lot of it comes back. I don't know, but interesting about the poor and the rich, and everyone is probably hurting. About 3 weeks ago, I preached on James 1:27. And this is a verse where God says, this is the kind of Christianity that I really love. In fact, he calls it pure and faultless. So God's like, you want to know the type of Christians that I think are wonderful? It's James 1:27. And it says, religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after orphans and widows in distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world or the coronavirus. And that pollution, of course, is talking about the ungodly philosophies of the world. But the first part of that verse, God says, the religion that I love, the Christianity I love, is when you take care of orphans and widows who are in distress. This is a picture of a local newspaper in Italy, of their obituary section. Usually, it's one page long in this town in Italy. It is now 10 pages long. And, of course, you know, Italy is up to 700, 800 people dying per day. And by the way, the United States is on track, if something isn't done, to not only match Italy, but go beyond it. And I look at all these people and I say to myself, there's a lot of widows and widowers and orphans being made. And so we're going to God's calling the church to look after the orphans and the widows and the older people that are going to have a difficult time getting out. The last sermon I preached with you was in James chapter 2, verse 14. Same kind of theme. James chapter 2, 14 says, what good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? If you're a true believer, then you will produce good deeds. You will be loving towards your neighbor. If you don't have deeds, there's something wrong with your faith. If you've asked Jesus Christ into your life and into your heart, he has to manifest himself from you loving others, just as he did when he walked on the earth. And so, though we're not saved by good deeds, we're saved by faith. If we really believe in the Lord, that faith produces love to other people. It then says, suppose a brother or a sister is without clothes and daily food, something that could literally happen during the coronavirus, the future here, someone without food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. So God's calling us to live out our Christianity, and people might be hurting now for food, for bills, for getting to the hospital, older folks being lonely that need someone to talk to. So So yesterday the Lord already put me to the test. We have, and they were online, we have this couple, and the husband, his name is Dave, and I shared, they were on the service. Dave just had major surgery and just came home. And yesterday I was talking to them, and Dave is supposed to take his temperature every day to make sure he doesn't have an infection from this major surgery. And they don't have a thermometer. And the wife went out to all the stores and the pharmacies, and there are no thermometers for sale. They're all gone. And the Lord is convicting me because 2 weeks ago, I went to Rite Aid and I bought a thermometer. And it was the last one on the shelf I bought. Now, maybe they've restocked and they're gone again. I don't know. But the Lord was speaking to me about, Joe, you have a thermometer. And I'm like talking to the Lord, but I need that thermometer. What if I get the coronavirus and I need to take my temperature? And the Lord was like, no. So I finally said to this couple, I have a thermometer that you can borrow. I said, you can borrow my thermometer, which sounds just so weird. It sounded like strange. I did tell them it's brand new. I haven't even opened it up. And so if they can't find a thermometer, I have one for them. Are we living out our faith? There was a book written nine years ago. And this is amazing because wait till you see the vocabulary of this book, because you would think it was written last week. But this actually was written 9 years ago. I've not read the book, but it's on your screen. There is a book called The Christian Atheist, Believing in God, but Living as If He Doesn't Exist. And here's how the book begins. Hi, my name is Craig Groeschel. He's the author of the book. And I'm a Christian atheist. For as long as I can remember, I've believed in God, but I haven't always lived like He exists. You might think it's odd for a pastor to struggle with living like there is no God. However, in my corner of the world, Christian atheism is a fast-spreading spiritual pandemic, which I was like, whoa, that's the terms we use for the coronavirus, pandemic. It's a spiritual pandemic which can poison, sicken, and even kill eternally. Yet Christian atheism is extremely difficult to recognize, especially by those who are infected. And the gist of the book is everyone's saying they're a Christian, but are we living out our Christianity? So, now we're up to speed. And I only want to preach a few more minutes on James chapter 4. And this is the new section. I know I skipped James 3. We'll probably have to come back to it in the weeks to come. But the Lord tonight wanted me to just share some truths on James 4, 13 to 17. So starting in verse 13. Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow, we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business, and make money. Why, you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it's the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. All such boasting is evil. If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. So I have 4 points. Brief. Point one, we all need to admit that we don't know what the future holds, at least in the close present future. Just like it says here, why you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. Now, I know what's going to happen way off. Well, see, I'm waiting for the coming of Jesus. So, when Jesus returns, he gathers his church. Then eventually we come back to the earth and he sets up 1,000 years of millennial reign when we reign with Jesus on the earth. At the end of the 1,000 years, he creates a new heaven and a new earth, and then there'll be no more death or sickness or crying or pain or sorrow or coronavirus. And we get to live in heaven for all eternity. I know that future, but I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. In fact, I'm getting all kinds of rumors, people writing me saying that the government is going to crack down the whole United States and put all of us into confinement for at least a couple of weeks. And some people say the governor of Pennsylvania is going to do that. It's even going to get tougher than it is. But I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. It drives us to live in the present. Proverbs 27:1, do not boast about tomorrow, for you do not know what a day may bring. Yesterday is history. It's passed by. That's why we call it past, because it's gone. It's past. Tomorrow is a mystery, but today is a gift. That's why they call it the present. And I think Jesus is trying to get the church back to trusting God and walking with Jesus day by day. Jesus himself said, and these are the words of Jesus, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. A lot of people in the church are really worried about tomorrow and next week and next month. But Jesus says, you know, focus on today. Seek my kingdom. Seek my will. Today we'll have enough worries. Don't worry, I'll be with you when tomorrow arrives. Second point, we need to be reminded of the brevity of life. The Lord says, what is your life? You are a mist that appears a little while and then vanishes. And you've all heard that, you know, when you look at a gravestone, it has the year you're born, the year you die, and that little dash in between represents your life. 2 days ago, my wife and I were watching a movie, and it was a movie on the Vietnam War. And it was sad watching young men on both sides of the war dying and being killed, and almost all of these men were like 18 to 20 years old. And I kind of just got sick in my spirit, the brevity of life. These men, women who lay down their lives, young lives, they don't even get to live very long. And so life can be short. I saw this saying, I thought it was interesting. The seven ages of man are spills when you're a baby, drills when you're in school, thrills when you're in college, spending all the money you borrow, the bills that follow you after college, the ills when you get older, the pills with the prescriptions, and then the wills. And all I notice is in all seven ages, ills is part of it. Third point, we need to seek out God's will for our lives. So the Lord says, instead, this is what we ought to say. If it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. Meaning that, you know, God, I know what I'm doing. We're very arrogant, boastful, thinking we're going to live a long time, have, you know, lots of money and all this. And God is using this, I think, to call us to move from prideful independence from the Lord to intentional dependence upon Jesus. Every day, God, what is your will for my life? If it's your will, if I'm going to serve you, I need your direction and your word. And the fourth point is act in obedience to what the Lord reveals and teaches you from his word and by his Holy Spirit. And that's in verse 17. If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. So each one of us, don't be a Christian atheist. The Lord will be speaking to you. And if the Lord reveals, here's what I'm calling you to do, some good for some other person, then we need to step out and do it, or it will be considered sin. I was reading about how the Christians acted during the last 2,000 years when plagues would hit in Europe. So I'm going to read here. What was it that the Christians had during the plagues in Europe that caused them to head toward the sick and dying to help them when everyone else were running away from them, trying to save their own lives? Could it be they loved Jesus more than they loved their own lives? Were they trying to love their neighbor as themselves? At one point, we don't know what it was, but in Rome, in the early, as the early church was still forming, a plague came through, and it may have been the measles or one of the diseases that now, you know, we have vaccines for. But it was killing 5,000 Romans a day. The politicians and the medical people fled from Rome. But the Christians stayed and ministered to all of these thousands of dying people. Now I'm going to pick up on your screen there. Did they understand their witness might be the final thing separating this person who was ill from entering eternity hopelessly lost, dying in their sins with no chance of a Savior to stand beside them at the great judgment? I've been thinking about the medical people, the doctors, the nurses, the orderlies, who are rushing in to minister and help people who are physically dying. Over in Rome, at least 2,629 health workers have been infected by the coronavirus. These are people rushing in at the cost of their own lives. And let's face it, probably the doctors and nurses are probably, as a group, fairly wealthy. If anyone can run away, if anyone can, you know, it would be them. But they are running in, I'm sure taking safety measures, but they're running in to help people who are hurting and dying. And we have doctors in our church and nurses in our church, and different people are having to work at pharmacies and banks and to help. So where's the church? I do believe if you're older and you have pre-existing, you know, health issues, you need to be careful. But I do think that the church needs to run and share the gospel and minister to people spiritually. There are so many people in the world. God has allowed this. I think Satan has brought the coronavirus. He means it for evil. Satan is the father of murder. But God can turn around this for his good. I think God's calling the church that we should run to the world that's hurting. They're in fear. They don't have purpose. They're losing their jobs. And we should be sharing the gospel by internet, by Facebook, by phone, by talking to our neighbor. I think the church should be just like the doctors and nurses, that we're running in to share the spiritual good news of Jesus. Well, I want to close, and I thought until we meet back together in our campuses every Sunday, and the link for this service will be the same for every Sunday until we shut it down. I thought we would do the Lord's Prayer together. And so I know you would just stay muted, but you would say it at home. I'll say it out loud. And if you would all pray along with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil and the virus. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Father, I just thank you for the church and for my wonderful brothers and sisters that have joined in tonight. May you bless them. May you protect them. May you give them Holy Spirit boldness and wisdom to share the gospel and to minister to people, not just with our words, Lord, but in actions, in deeds, in helping people out, that they would see the reality of Jesus in each one of our lives. May Satan be bound. May the coronavirus be bound. May you help our government in bringing an end to this and bring back some normalcy. And we just plead for your mercy and your help. May the church grow strong through this, Lord Jesus. We pray in your name. Amen.